Good morning, everyone, and I hope you had a lovely Easter Sunday. It is Monday, and it is April. It is April. It is April. We are one quarter of the way into 2024. We're going into the second quarter, y'all. And I don't know. It's just flying by, isn't it? I feel like I've missed the first quarter because, of course, as you know, or if you don't know, I had COVID and it just took me out of the game. It took my whole calendar for January, February, and March out of the game. All these great ideas that I had and planning on my calendar. I'm trying to finagle and I'm trying to bring back because I'm starting to get my energy back. I'm starting to feel more like myself, which is fantastic. And I'm just looking at my notes here, trying to think about what's going on. What am I doing today? Self-care Sunday. I had a lot of tips in self-care Sunday. And I hope you got a chance to see it. But if you didn't, I don't know how we got on this topic yesterday at my own Easter dinner. We were watching, my husband has on had on every Holy movie at least two or three times, Charlton Heston, John Derek in The King of Kings, which it's the most beautiful Jesus I have ever seen in my life. He jogged that memory. I forgot how beautiful John Derek was. And for those of you that don't know, this is Bo Derek's husband. Remember Bo? I'm going to put a picture of John. Maybe John is Jesus. He's gorgeous. And then Beau. We all remember Beau Derek, if you're old enough, Beau running on the beach with her cornrows. So beautiful. You can go to any island and they will cornrow your hair. So everyone calm down. They will cornrow your hair. And she was on an island and they cornrowed her hair. And she's running on the beach and this champagne gold color one piece bathing suit. It's like it's just etched in our mind, these things from our past, right? Like I could still see Farrah Fawcett in her red. Was it a red tank top or a red, I think, well, red bathing suit with her beautiful smile and her winged hair. But I don't know how we got on this topic, but I was reliving the 80s once again, and this is technically 1979, but here we go. I got to do a little fast forward on this because, there's just a part of this song that I love. So I'm going to give you all an earworm because this is all I sang throughout Easter dinner yesterday was David Naughton, American Werewolf in London. And I was like, wait a minute, this was a line dance. So of course I went looking for the line dance, and me being dyslexic and they weren't giving you any instructions. You just was like, oh, this is easy, unless you're dyslexic. So everybody was going left and I was going right, everybody was going up and I was going back. I drove my son nuts yesterday. I'm like, who are you kidding? You love the 80s now. I know you were born in 86, but I still got you in there. I'm probably going to get flagged for this because I'm playing David Naughton in the background, but I don't care. I was 16 years old and I was line dancing. Let me tell you something about this song. It is uplifting. It is motivating. It is summer. It is raging hormones. It is roller skates. It's a cowbell and a violin. Come on. When have you ever seen that combo together? I got my Wonder Woman hair clip out. I'm reliving 1979 for some reason, and Bo Derek, when she did 10, was 1979. So I think I'm gonna take David off. So I'm giving you all the earworm that I got yesterday. And now that I've done my intro and you guys are saying, is this girl crazy? Put my Wonder Woman clip in. Yes, I am. And let's get to some diamond painting. I am still with my Winter Fox. I have my notes here. I should keep them out. But I want to show you guys something. If you missed a self-care Sunday, and I'm going to show you what I'm talking about. Should I turn this around? I don't know. If you missed self-care Sunday, so there she is. Okay. So I did the entire right side of my painting. And so when I was diamond painting the right side, I had her this way. Here we go. I spun her around and I was working on her sideways because it was easier than leaning over my diamond painting. So you see where her head is, right? Okay. So now I am diamond painting the left side, and I did change to release paper because Foofy is driving me nuts, jumping on my desk and eating the washi paper off. So now I'm diamond painting this way, and her head is different, right? Or am I just losing my mind? So when I was diamond painting, the arrows going towards the right and the arrows going towards the left are now still, they're in the right direction. Because when they were on that side, I was making sure the arrows were pointing the right way for the grid, for the drill space. So now I'm still checking, but now that they're on the other opposite side of the diamond painting, they are actually going the right way. There was no need to check. They were going the right way. So I came up with putting a piece of washi tape that says bottom and top on my painting so that when I'm pulling my drills out, and we have these drills that are, you know, multiples, they're arrows going to the right, arrows going to the left, and we have our painting turn. So you don't make the boo-boo that I made, which was a huge one. This was the arrow pointing. This is the color for the arrow pointing towards my mirror. And I looked it from it from this way and said, oh, no, it's the other color, which was this color. So I had this color all on this side. I had to dig these all out. And I really should have made a little video of how I did that because I will tell you, I used my aligner that I have to pull my drills up. And it was very easy to just take my aligner and put it flush with the drills and just scoop them out from under. My hands in the way. And just scoop them out from under and pull them up, and I put them back in the tray. So that made it easy. Another thing that I do, I know, I'm sorry if I'm repeating myself if you saw Self-Care Sunday, but you know, just a little recap. Is I have a designated set of cuticle scissors that I only use for my diamond painting. And it is so much easier to pull your drills up with a, you see how it's just, it'll be flush to the diamond painting, and I'll be able to grab it and pull it up as opposed to using my tweezers that I'm always afraid I'm going to, these are really sharp, I'm always afraid that I'm going to puncture. And then you also end up sometimes sliding your hand and you scratch your drills. So that's what I wanted to say about that thing. So let me see, we went through April. Another thing, as I get myself ready to diamond paint, let's get my stuff out. Yes, I still use my skinny placers. I absolutely do. And I try to remind myself to reiterate that point to you because, you know, you don't, these fancy diamond painting pens, which, you know, I was using this until I broke, once again, the placer inside the diamond painting pen. So I'm out of commission with this one, with this guy. So I do have my fancy diamond painting pens, and I love them. I do. But you don't need anything. And this is a big canvas. And I diamond paint with my skinny placers just as much as I do with my fancier placers that I have. So me and Putty are now friends. I have been using Putty. I'm going to clean this one out, and that's what I use my tweezer for. I'm afraid actually to clean this putty out, because that means I have to open the package. And when Foofy hears the package, he decides that he thinks it's a treat, because he hears me opening up the cellophane package to get my putty out. And I will tell you that this skinny placer is warped. I get these from Amazon, and you could see the little ripples from all the drills that have been here before. Oh my gosh. But I love it. And I actually love this little diamond painting pen that I have. I don't know. I don't know if it's the width, the length, but you know, you find what works for you and you stay with it. And sometimes these diamond painting pens, they get a little heavy. That black one that I took out just now is so, 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 so heavy. But I love it. I love the weight of it, but I keep that for my little bite size paintings. And then yeah, I do take it out too. So now let's see if the monster comes. I had bought him a bell, a pet training bell, to try and get him to tap the bell for his treat. So I'm in the middle of that training. And once I get it down, you know, of course I'm going to tape Foofy using his bell. But we bought him these bonker treats, and they have them now. They were just like little crunchy treats, and he loves them. He's going into the cabinet and he's pulling them out. This is how much he loves these treats. And I had to take them out of here, because every time I went to go sit down, he was like, oh, she's diamond painting. She's not paying attention to me. Yeah. Okay. I raised a kid, Foofy. I raised a kid. My ears have been pinned back since 1986. Since 1986. If you're a mom, you know what I'm talking about. Your ears are still pinned back in your head listening for sound. So I hear him, and I kept getting up, and I'm like, I got to move these treats. So we took him to go get his nails clips, which didn't happen. Didn't happen at PetSmart. They were like, no, he's growling at us and whatnot. We can't do it. And he still got treats anyway. And Bonkers came out with these lollipops, which is a piece of freeze-dried chicken. And he literally came at me and John. We have scratch marks on us. John has got bite marks on him. He's a terror. He's a terror. He's a terror. If you ever saw the movie Sandlot, which is about these little boys growing up in like maybe the 50s, 60s maybe, and they form a baseball team, there's a part of the show where they keep hitting their balls over into the neighbor's yard, but the beast lives in the neighbor's yard, and they're terrified of the beast. And I'm gonna put fresh putty in this one too. And we're gonna go, is this the same one? This is a 9, this is an 8, but this is one of those skinny placers again. And so the beast it takes their baseballs. And they try and get in the yard to get the baseball out, but the beast is still like attacking them. It's funny. The dog, of course, just only wants to play. And we call Foofy a dog because he's not like a cat at all. He's like a dog. Now he's got a new thing. He pulled his bed out of the little chair. He has a little pet bed, and he pulls the lining out. He doesn't want the bed inside the lining. He wants it on the floor, so he pulls it out. What else went on with Self-Care Sunday? Let me think. Oh, I promised you guys during Self-Care Sunday this is something that just kind of materialized, and I'll tell you why I love it. What has materialized is I watch a lot of diamond painters, and when I find someone that I really like that I think that you will enjoy, I passed them on to you. And I was talking about, oh, I would love to find some male diamond painters, and you know, just ask and you shall receive. Because right after I did Self-Care Sunday, I was waiting for John, and I was just like going through YouTube, and I found two male diamond painters, and how adorable. Let me just tell you, ladies, and men too, if you're out there, make yourself known. One channel was Diamond Painting with Mike. He was doing a little chick, a little Easter chick. It was a little Easter scene that he was doing. And the other was, I watched Mike for a little bit. He was talking about, on his channel, he was talking about just current events. He was talking about what had happened with the bridge collapse, which is horrifying. And the second guy that I found, it's called Diamond Painting with Jim. And Jim, let me tell you, leave it to the guys, ladies, leave it to the guys. Jim, wait till you see what he's doing. Jim has found a way, a new way to diamond paint. He's found a new diamond painting pen. And that was just fascinating. So we'll get into that. And then I'm going through my notes because I just forget things and then I make notes along the way. I'm going to go back to two diamond painters that I introduced you guys to, Lizette Craft and Tells, because Lizette, what was interesting and why I introduced her to you guys was Lizette had 52 diamond paintings that she started but did not complete, and she said, finally, enough, you know, I'm not buying anything. I am going to finish what I started and I'll put a little picture of this painting up here and where I actually am in this painting. She said, that's it. I had enough. I'm not, not buying anything. And so why I introduced you guys to her, and I'm just clearing out my drills right here. Oh gosh, I made a mess. Oh, these are the drills. I'm saying, why are they not moving? These are all the drills that I had to pull off. And they're all stuck together because there's glue underneath them. And I don't know if I'm going to be able to... What did I just tell you guys that I used? Designated. I used my... my jewel here. And you could see how easy, like, it just picks it up. But they're sticky because when I pulled them up off the canvas, you know, I made sure I got them down really good. And where's my aligner at? Here it is. Let's see if we get them out this way. They're kind of clumpy. I don't know that I'm going to be able to use these again. I don't think I will be. Maybe. I don't know. I'm going to keep these as a reserve, and then if I run out, I'll go back and pull a few out. Also, another tip, I take these little squishies that we get in our kits for all these trays that don't have a stopper, and that's what I use them for. I guess I could wash these off. They're not too bad, but I'm going to use them as a reserve. I'm not going to use them on my painting just yet because I did pull them off. Can't get this washi tape either to stay down, and it just drives me nuts. I bought this washi tape from Amazon, and it just does not, it doesn't do a good job at all. And so that's why I have a glue stick here. I know I'm jumping from one thing to another, but I'm going to keep the glue stick out because there's something else I want to tell you about this glue stick. Okay. I'm going to keep this out as a mental reminder. So Lizette said, no more. I'm going to finish these 52 paintings. It took her 2 years. But out of this experience, she has just this week put on her YouTube channel a system that she developed, a log, so that she, because she is so committed to keeping her stash under control, she developed a system. And I'm happy to say that I, you know, introduced her to you guys. And then this came about, and I just love these things that come about through your own creative journey, and then you share them with others. And so I love that. And then Diamond Painting Dark, I haven't been over at her page. I know that she did a 24-hour diamond painting, and that's what interests me about her. She was doing a charity event for cancer, and so she diamond painted for 24 hours, and that was fascinating to watch. She's very interesting. I like her diamond paintings that she does. I just found it very interesting. And then when I find an interesting diamond painter, I, you know, like to pass it on to you guys, and let me know what you think. So Diamond Painting Gym. Let's talk about Diamond Painting Gym. And let me tell you something. His channel says men diamond paint too. And I'm getting confused here. Here we go. So I just want to show you one thing. See these arrows that are going this way? If you have your little washi tape here in the corner, you could say this is the top of my diamond painting. When you're on this side, they're facing the right way. But on the other side, they're facing that way. So so Diamond Painting Gym. Let me tell you, I found a lot of diamond paintings that I've done myself on his channel. And let me tell you something else. Diamond Painting Gym took the leap into, what's the name of it? I think I wrote it down. Oops. Have outside the sweet shop. Outside the sweet shop. I'm gonna post a picture of Diamond Painting Gym and his channel down below so you know. So yes, he did Outside the Sweet Shop, which that is so full of confetti. I don't know how many colors it is, but it is a beautiful diamond painting. Oh my gosh. I know I saw one of his videos where he said that his wife was joining him with a diamond painting, and I think that they may have been working on a diamond painting together, and I wonder if that was the one. So, and then, so Diamond Painting Gym, the last video that I watched of his, he was introducing his subscribers to a diamond painting pen that he found. Now, it kind of looked like this. It kind of looked like a big pen, right? And just say that this is your diamond painting point. This was on this end. And then there was a tube coming down, just like an ink tube, a tube coming down and a little attachment here that went to a pump that was like a mini vacuum. And so Jim is not using any wax or putties. He is picking up his drills through a vacuum one by one and putting them on. And I'll tell you, I like using my placers. I don't know if there was a placer attachment. I did not see one during this demo that he was doing. But if you're a single placer, it was pretty cool. It was pretty cool. I was like, it reminded me of that show. What's his name? What do I have in here? What was his name? Tim the Tool Man. He used to always be making this stuff for his wife, Jill, and his three boys. He was always in the garage. He has a show on now, too. It's like, what is it, Last Man Standing or something? Oh, I can't think of his name. It reminded me, it's like such a guy thing. Like, we're going to turn this whole diamond painting thing upside down. But I believe that the product was made in Germany. And the box was all in German. I believe he may be in Copenhagen. Because I saw a diamond painting from Copenhagen. But I'm telling you, he did Foxy Lady. And I said, I have to really turn him on when he's doing his own little whip and chat. I just watched the demonstration, but I found him so interesting that I said, I'm gonna pass him on to my subscribers if they're looking for an interesting diamond painter to watch. And then about a week ago,
Again, I'm scrolling. You know, when you first start diamond painting and you're looking for videos, you find all these, very well-known diamond painters that are out there. They come up, right away in the search. And, for a while there, I was, listening to them, and I love their channels. I don't watch them regular. I don't watch them as often as I used to. And I think because I was getting like, when you see like somebody dropping a video every day, and you're trying to build your channel, it's like, oh my God, how do they do this? How do they drop a video every day? And they're current because they're talking about things that are current. And they're doing events, and it gets like a little bit, it can really work on your psyche when you're trying to build your channel and you're trying to find your audience. And I don't want to feel, because that's what my self-care Sunday was about comparative standards. I don't want to be compared to anyone, and I don't want to compare myself to anyone, and I don't want to compare anyone to me. And when I fear that I'm getting into that mindset, it's like I need to take a breather. I need to find other, and there's all different kinds of diamond painters. There's diamond painters that are very, technical all the way through. I'm a little bit of a goofball. Might be why I'm not getting as far as I want to get. I'm dancing around on my channel. But, there's something for everyone. And like I said, you just have to find your audience. It's just like when I was, teaching yoga, I had my teachers that I liked, and I, have to find my own. I have to find my own audience, my own students. And I did. I'm pulling this up here. Here we go. Let's get that out of there. And here we go. Get this one. Yeah, so I started to expand what I was watching, and not just watching. I'm making a mess here with this one line. Boy, it's Monday, isn't it? Oh, Monday, I'm sorry. I don't like giving you a label, but yeah, so I tried to expand what I was watching, and look for other diamond painters that were, I don't want to say intense, because I mean, if you love what you do, it's not work for you to make multiple videos and get them out there. It's just not. You're loving what you do, and that's the way it comes off. It comes off like it's so easy. I'm sure it's not, but they're making it look like it is. So I was again watching my YouTube videos, and I come across what I see. Is the Birth of Venus. And I'm like, oh, I love the Birth of Venus. I have a portrait done by a very famous artist here in Philly, a friend of mine. His name is Perry Milo. He's a pop artist. And one of the paintings that I have, he's done paintings of my restaurant when I was in Rittenhouse Square. I have that. But when I was leaving Philly and moving to New York, and I was opening up my own cafe, I was hoping that Perry was going to be able to come out and paint a mural for me of this idea that I had for my cafe. And his life was moving in another direction, and I was moving out of Philly, and we couldn't connect. And but I bought a picture of his rendition of The Birth of Venus, and it's in my bedroom. I still have to get it on my wall. I'm trying to recreate parts of what's at my bedroom. It's in my art room. I'm trying to recreate parts of Petal Bell in my room because I just loved my cafe. I loved it. I loved parts of it. I loved being, my idea for Petal Bell never really got to fruition because I had a partner. And they took it in another direction, and I just never felt like I was in my cafe. And so I'm recreating my cafe and the elements that I brought into it into my art room. That's what I'm trying to say here. And so when I saw this Birth of Venus, I'm like, oh my God. And it was like bite size.
And I think that's why I like, come on, look at the winter fox. I think that this is why I love this painting so much. She reminds me also of the birth of Venus. Look at that hair and the red hair. You know, it's said that Italians with red hair were royalty. So I see this little bite size birth of Venus. Am I in the right spot? No, I'm not. I'm over a little bit more right here. And I'm like, oh, where did she get that at? I love it. And let me see, the name of her channel is Tiny Worlds of Wonder. And what she was doing was, and I've seen this done before, I've seen creating your own canvas. I've seen that done before, but the way that she did it was so easy to understand. And I'm just trying to make sure I'm in the right spot. Okay. So easy to understand. And I love that she took this Botticelli, The Birth of Venus, and she made it her own. She kind of like off made it really artsy, and I love artsy stuff. And she showed you how she went onto the site and how she made the dimensions and how she picked the threads and how she went over and then got her drills. And it was very interesting. And she loves the masters. So, and a lot of her work is masterwork. So if you love the masters, and I just love, I loved the way it came out. Oh, actually, this started because she got a box from a company. Oh gosh, who was it? It kind of reminded me of those diamond dot boxes where they gave her a blank canvas to create her own. It had like a lot of stuff in it. Oh, I can't remember. Sorry. But I'm just trying to, you know, say how she got onto this. And she was like, you know what? They sent me a blank canvas. Because there are, I know that Katie from Diamonds and Washi does a cross-stitch conversion to a diamond painting, which looks really interesting. Now, I used to cross-stitch. I cross-stitched all the time that I was pregnant with my son, Josh, because I was doing his birth announcement in cross stitch. And you know, you're looking at a blank canvas and you are counting the cross. I did count a cross stitch. You're counting where you're putting your stitches at. And that when I watched Katie do it, I would say that that's pretty much the same way. I'm making sure I'm on this line. And so that's what she was doing. She was doing like a count at cross stitch and turning it into a diamond painting. And I just thought it was fascinating watching her do it. And the Botticelli, I'm going to put a picture down here, came out so, so beautiful. So beautiful. And I'm like, oh, I have to do this. She only had one caveat, and that was that she felt as though, how was it on that line? She felt as though you could see the grid lines, because there are grid lines on your blank canvas. So that was one thing that she didn't like. But I'll tell you, I didn't care. I thought that it added to the painting, because someone would look at it and say, you know, you could, you know, when you say I made this, and they could see the grid lines in the background. It's like, oh my gosh, like you put these all in, you know, one by one, you followed this grid. I just think it added to the portrait. That's just my opinion. I thought it added to the portrait. So I really enjoyed watching her. I really enjoyed her channel. I really enjoy her. She's got a very pleasant voice, and you know, she did a very good job at explaining that, but still making it fun and easy breezy, you know, like, you know, just really having fun with it and not being too technical. And Lizette is the same way. Lizette is the same way. I think she's having fun with her experience in
And I love that story. I love that, you know, you say to yourself one day, no, I'm not buying anything else. I'm putting my canvases away. I'm putting my credit card away, I meant to say. And I am not buying another canvas until these 52 that I have are done. And that took her 2 years to do that. And out of it, she birthed a system. That might be something that you go, you know what? I like this system. And it's a way, she's back to buying canvases, but she's allowing herself an allotment. And I believe that that's kind of what the system is. Don't take it from me. Go to Lizette and find out. Is that she devised this system so that you stay committed to not having a... Now, I look at some channels. I mean, people are creating... YouTube videos on just their stash. Oh, here's my stash. And I'm like, oh my God. Oh my God. I you know, or people that do videos on the amount of pens that they have. I mean, I love pens. I'm a writer. I could show you the pens that I have in my house, and I still go to the store. If I go to like a Staples or a dollar store, I'm right in the pen section. I'm like, you're one person. How many pens do you need? But yeah, I do. I buy pens. We're always looking for that pen that is going to be like, this is the one that I pull out all the time. Currently, I'm using a pen that I've gotten from the dollar store. I like, you know, there's something more to the pen than just the pen. It's the weight. It's the ink. It's the scratch on the paper. Yep, that's a big thing. In fact, I found another YouTuber that I like, but it's about writing, and he's a journaler, and he does really interesting videos on all different kinds of writing. And I watched where he did this one video where you've probably seen this, and I've seen this in my past and never understood it. But a letter would come to you and it would be written in this beautiful calligraphy. And then the paper would, so you would write, you could see the notes that I made for my whip and chat today, right? There they are, whip and chat, that's it. So you would write in this beautiful calligraphy and you would receive this letter. And, you know, and then the letter would turn this way and the writing would continue, maybe in a different weight, like maybe a lighter calligraphy, like you're not pressing down so hard on the paper, and in a different ink. And I was like, what is that about? But really it was to didn't have the paper. And so they would write one way and then they would write this way. And it was so interesting. And his name, of course, he has the perfect name. His name is Hemingway. And I will link him down below. And I better put this on my list of things that I do. Let me put it right on here so I remember to link that for you guys. He's really interesting when it comes to being a journaler. And he's another pen collector. He has beautiful pens for writing. So these are the things that I watch. Not just lost in the 80s over here. Well, 1979, technically. But we had so much fun, didn't we? Didn't we have fun? And, you know, that song is not only, you know, making it. It's not, let me just tell you, here's the other thing. Now, I don't know how we got into this discussion because we were watching King of Kings with beautiful John Derrick as Jesus. But I think my husband was saying that one of the guys in the movie played a part in Batman, the TV show that we all had as kids. And I think he was confusing him with like, oh, what did he say it was? Oh, I don't know. But anyway, he actually was one of the bad guys on the TV show Batman. So, I don't know how we got into this. I don't know how I got into David Naughton and this show making it. I don't know. But I said to my husband John, I said, you know, that show Making It was based on Saturday Night Fever. And he's like, no, it wasn't. I'm like, yes, it was. And he's like, no, it wasn't. I'm like, yes, it was. So I had to Wikipedia it. And of course it was. Of course it was. And I said, don't you remember he worked at the Tasty Treats, the ice cream shop. And then at nighttime, he was like the all he wanted to do was dance, disco. So my husband was convinced that I was confused, but I wasn't. I was right. I was right. I just sent him this meme, and I'll put that down below too. Let me write it on here. Meme. Hemingway plus meme. I sent him this little meme of this guy. His wife is leaning over his shoulder. It's like one of those crazy e-cards that they take these old pictures and they put quotes on them. And he's sitting at the table and he's holding his head and his wife is behind the chair. And he's like, you know, I've had it with you telling me for the past 30 years of my marriage that I'm wrong. And she says, 31. I had to get Wikipedia involved. You didn't believe me. But let me tell you something else about this show. It was only 9 episodes. What the hell? Unless he went off to go be the American Werewolf. I don't know. But that was his big hit. It was a Billboard hit. And let me tell you something about this song. You know, we were on roller skates. That's another thing that they were watching yesterday. They were watching Rollerball with James Caan. And I'm like, oh, look at the roller skates. They were like on the 4 rollers. Because I can't rollerblade. Get the hell out of here. Me? Forget it. I can't walk in a straight line. So, let me tell you something about this song. It's uplifting and motivating. And that, you know how many people have adopted that they're going through cancer treatments and stuff. And they're, you know, they're breaking loose from, you know, a job, you know, and they're looking for a new job and they're starting their YouTube channels or like me, and you know, and they've adopted this song as kind of like their anthem. This is it. I'm making it. And we just had great song. We had great music. I mean, that's so uplifting. It was all about the hand claps, you know, and the line dancing. We had fun roller skating at the rink. Oh God. My son was busy laughing. And he thought I didn't catch him. I was like, you better delete every picture that you took of me trying to line dance this song that I can't remember anything anymore. Can't even remember how to grapevine. We had fun though. And then I found another YouTube channel. I think it's called Disco Saturday Night. I'll link that too. If you like this music and it gets you going, Disco Saturday Night, he has all the, you know, like just those songs that get you up. You can't sit down. You can't. And if you can't get up, you're waving your hands in the air. And if you can't wave your hands, you're nodding your head. You're tapping your toes. You know, just great. Great, great songs. Great, you know, uplifting and motivational music. I love it. I love it. So, yeah, John had all the holy movies on. And then he would fall asleep. I was like, I can't take any more of Charlton Heston. I really can't. You know, you can't, this movie is like 4 hours long and you keep falling asleep. You know, it was a big event when we were growing up. You know, we only had like, what, we had like 3 channels. We had 3, 6, 10. Then you had 12, which was PBS. You had 17, you had 48, you had 29. That was it. That was it. We didn't have any. Every now and again, you got that crazy channel that came in. It was almost like an episode of Lost in Space. When you were trying, we had rabbit ears, I'm telling you. And you were trying to like get that one channel in that was in between or after channel 48. I think it was called channel 78. And it would have like, you know, you'd be like, oh my God, I see something. Like an episode of Lost. There's people in there. They're broadcasting something. What are they showing? You know. And it was just maybe like another PBS channel. But we always got our homework done really quickly after school. I'm trying, in the back of my mind, I'm trying to put together John Derek and David Naughton. And I can't. But that, it's like one of those songs. It's just like, it's high energy and it makes you feel good and you love singing along. There's this girl on Instagram that during the pandemic started to make little clips of herself dancing to 80s music. And she's a riot. She's a riot. She'll film herself like just doing something ordinary in the kitchen, like cleaning the sink or something. And then all of a sudden her jam comes on, like TLC comes on or something. And then she goes right back to 1986 and she's dancing all around her kitchen or her living room or doing stuff. And it's just so funny, but it's so true. You know, when we hear our music, and especially the 80s, I mean, you saw Dancing on Air. How about Soul Train? Remember that? Remember Soul Train? It's the Soul Train. I know I'm killing everything today. I'm just killing everything today. It's a Monday. I'm drinking coffee that's left over from Dunkin' Donuts Box of Joe. Okay, because they were like, oh yeah, I want coffee, I get coffee. And I sent my husband to the corner to go get a box of Joe. And I got like 3/4 of a box left. I'm like, guess what? I'm drinking that coffee this morning. Not throwing it out. I put it in the refrigerator. It was my intention to have iced coffee, but I keep telling myself one of these days I'm going to be drinking iced coffee. I never do. It could be 110 outside. I'm not drinking iced coffee. In fact, me and my husband were having this conversation this morning before he left for work, because he does listen to my self-care Sunday, and it was about the practice of being real and how, you know, it's based on the reading by Mark Nepo for March 31st, if you have the Book of Awakening, and how we pretend that we're not hurt when we are, and, you know, we're not really ever dealing with the hurt. I think that we deal with the fact that we pretended, because I'm still ruminating about things that I didn't do when someone hurt me. I kind of acted like it didn't happen, but it did happen. So, and then I think back, like my husband was recounting something that he was hurt about, and he's like, you know, I should have never, there's nothing I could do about it now, it's over, but I should have never, did what I did, because things would be different today. And I'm like, and it's not a bad thing, it's a good thing, but he doesn't see it that way. You know, he feels as though he gave something away that he shouldn't have, and it makes him very sad that it's not his anymore, just his alone. And we've all been there. We give something away that we want to share with someone, and then we go, oh, you know, maybe I shouldn't have done that, you know, because it's not just mine anymore. I just went to go get my Social Security card with my name changed on it. And when we went to Social Security, I didn't have the old one. And he's like, well, do you have your marriage certificate? I said, no. And John was like, what the hell are you doing here? He's like, you came here, you have nothing that you need. So we went home and the guy said to me, if you have your old Social Security card, bring it with you. And I, of course, brought it. It was still pristine. They gave it to me when I was 16 years old because I graduated high school and I was ready to go out for a job and you needed a Social Security card. And so they didn't give them to you when you were born. Like they gave my son his when I had him. You went when you were of age and you went and got your Social Security card. And I had it still pristine because when you got it, there was a little machine on your way out. It was a laminating machine and you got a little piece of lamination for a quarter, and you put your card in there and you laminated it. And the, and my signature was on there from when I was 16 years old. And I, of course, went back with it. And there was something in me saying, they're going to take this from you. And I went with it anyway. And I could have just said, I can't find it. Because he said to me, the guy said to me, when you come back, do you know where your Social Security card is? And I said, oh, yeah, it's in my safe. And he said, oh, bring it back with you. And I'm, when I brought it in, I'm looking at it and I said, oh God, look at my signature from when I was 16 years old and look at it. It's pristine. It's brand new. And it said on it, not for identification purposes, which now everybody's always asking me for your social, which I don't understand. I give my social to no one. And after he was done taking all the information for my new card, he said, I have to take this from you because you're not Elisa Sokola anymore. You're Elisa Pescatore. And I just felt my heart sink. Like, why didn't I listen to myself? Because there were that's like, that's a part of me. It's a part of my life, a part of my history, a part of who I was. That little girl, that little signature, getting her social. So I understood what he was saying about giving something away, that, you know, it's not mine anymore, you know. And oh God, it makes me sick when I think about my card is out there. It's not safely in my safe. It's in a Social Security. Oh, I hope he destroyed it, you know. Maybe he destroyed it. And there's a part of me like, of course I'm Elisa. I'm still Elisa Sokola. I'm still my father's daughter. But, you know, it's like that little pang that you get that you have something that you don't, that you had something that was yours and it's not yours anymore. Yeah, so I kind of understood where my husband was coming from about, you know, giving something away that is yours and, you know, it's not just yours anymore. And so I started to think about April and Self-Care Sunday and, you know, I was going through my notes that I had that I made in the beginning of the year for things that I wanted to do on this channel that didn't come to fruition because of COVID and getting sick, but other things did, you know, other things came to, new ideas came to me and new things that I'm doing. But one thing that I did do was I got together for you guys a could-do list for your self-care. So it's like, I didn't want it to be a list for April. I didn't want to put you under any pressure that you have to get it done by this time. Like, oh, the month of April, you know, look at your self-care list and, you know, take something off and see if you can incorporate it into your life. I like could-do lists, not to-do lists. And I just put some stuff like for every day of April of like what you could do. Like, you could go out and buy yourself a composition book and start to keep a journal or maybe just a gratitude journal or an art journal. You could go out and buy yourself a glue stick. Now, this is something that I started. I used to carry, that's why I took the glue stick out. I used to carry a glue stick in my handbag. And every time I got something that was interesting, like I went to go get a little gemstone at Garland of Letters. I used to go to a lot on South Street for those of you that are from Philly. And they wrapped my little gemstone up in this beautiful like, kind of rice paper. And it was purplish in color and gold. I was like, oh my God, this is such a pretty little piece of paper to wrap. And even though it was like distressed from being wrapped with a gemstone, I still took it and glued it inside my journal. And then I went back and I sketched on it. I actually was looking at my gemstone and I actually sketched my, you know, very, you know, not high art, and sketched my gemstone on it. And I wrote a little note that I got this piece of paper from Garden of Letters and I bought this purple stone, amethyst stone, and it's in my window. And, you know, or I would save like, I had a beautiful cup of tea and like the, usually the tag on the tea has like the name of the tea on it and the, you know, who made it and took that off. And then before you know it, you're starting an art journal without even knowing it. You're just collecting these like little pieces of paper or things that seem interesting, or maybe you rip something out of a magazine and you just glue it in.
other things, like go for a walk, maybe take your phone with you and use your camera to shoot some pictures of anything that catches your eye. Like these are all like moments in self-care, and they're kind of also blending in the morning pages in like baby steps and like an artist date that you do. Like just little things that I thought about that, you know, close your eyes and breathe in and breathe out, you know, breathe in through your nose, and breathe out through your mouth, and do that 10 times. Maybe that's what you do today for self-care. Maybe, you know, yes, of course, make time for your favorite hobby, but you know, diamond painting, maybe you set a goal because for yourself that when you diamond paint, you set a timer and you then take a break from your diamond painting and you stretch your hands and you maybe pull your fingers back to give them a break and you roll your wrists and maybe you incorporate, you piggyback that deep breathing too. You relax your eyes, you know, something new because I'm coming to the end. I have like 5 minutes left on my video before it says, no, you can't video anymore. It's something that I've been doing and I actually put this on my list too, is to give yourself a scalp massage. Because during COVID, I started to lose my hair. Every time I brushed my hair was coming out in droves. And I bought myself some rosemary oil. You can make your own. There's plenty of recipes out there if you want to make your own. They have these like little combs that you can, it'll dispense the oil. But I bought myself some rosemary oil and I bought myself a scalp massager. You can get them anywhere. They have them in the dollar store. You just hold them in your hand and you let the oil go in, and maybe that's what you do for self-care. There are just 30 could do things to do for self-care. So I'm going to take that little template and then I will let you know where it's going to be somewhere in this video. I don't know if you could put a template on YouTube. I don't know if I have to put it on Buy Me a Coffee or my Facebook page or my Instagram page. I'm really trying to, my personal goal for April is to be proactive with my socials because I did have a diamond painting company say, you know, we'd like to partner with you, but you know, I don't know why it's important that you don't have the numbers. And I think too, yes, of course, there's people out there with huge numbers when it comes to diamond painting. We all know who they are, but there's all different diamond painters. And yeah, I might be the little guy, but some people found me and I don't really look like the diamond painters that I like and that I'm telling you guys about. I don't really look to see what their audience is. I'm just like, oh, that's a good idea. Oh, I want to show my subscribers this. And, oh, I want to introduce you to my subscribers because I think that you, you know, are just awesome. You're loving what you do and you're developing new systems and you're finding new ways to diamond paint and you're creating your own canvases. I don't know how many people subscribe to our channel. It's not anything that I looked at. It was not a deciding factor in introducing her to you guys. Anyway, enjoy your Monday. I hope you still have your earworm. I hope you're still dancing to David Naughton. I hope you look him up. Tell me if you learned the line dance. And I will see you guys in the next one. Bye. Create the world you want to live in. Bye, guys.